Michael E. Parker, and we are here again on CLTV Live. I hope you have a great Monday going on. And as promised, I have Miss Jahlil Stewart back
Thank
in studio.
You, sir.
Welcome once again.
Good to be here.
Now, as promised, you said you would come back.
Happy to be here.
Listen, we had a great show last week talking about your journey.
Yes.
And tonight, we talked about coming back together to talk about transferable skills. So as you all look on the screen, this is the night where we're gonna talk about transferable skills. And remember, our new show time is now at 6:30 p.m. and they are 30 minutes long. And so remember that, get the word out, the new format here at URCL. But tonight, this is a topic that I think both of us are excited about.
Very much so.
Right, because in your field of human resources, yeah, you deal a lot with, we used to say, KSAs, I think,
yes,
knowledge, skills, and ability.
That's
you didn't know,
right.
You know,
nice.
I'm gonna pull that out. So before
nice.
We get into transferable skills, just yeah, how important are skills in general? What does skills even mean to you?
Oh gosh, that's a deep question. It's a good question. I mean, a general skill is an ability to do something, to get something done.
Right.
You have to have a skill. Different types of skills, professional skills, technical skills,
right,
behavioral skills.
Interpersonal.
But, yeah, exactly.
Right.
Just
right.
learning. The true skill is knowing how, having the competency and ability to get something done.
Right, and I think, when you think about us all being CEOs of our life, You know, essentially, skills is almost like something we can put in our briefcase, right? And it's like equipment. It's like, you know, weapons, armory. But
your arsenal.
It's your arsenal,
it's,
right?
And it's your, I love that about a skill, though. Once you have it, it's yours.
Absolutely. And so when you think about that, though, some of that arsenal, not all of it, you can bring with you. So I think that's the key about transferable skills and maybe non-transferable skills. And so I think that's really important about the fact that there's some skills you can actually bring with you.
Yes. And I think what comes to my mind, like I mentioned, technical skills, behavioral skills, professional skills. A technical skill, let me just use hypothetically welding. You can use a welding skill in a welding environment. You can't use a welding skill maybe in a professional environment.
Absolutely. And so when you think about that, I mean, so let's jump into this a little bit, because I know we have a specific amount of time and we can get so, you know, going on this. But let's look at this for a minute. Forbes magazine put something up that was really important that Forbes magazine kind of called out. What are the 7 transferable skills that they felt were like the most skills that someone can have? Now, Forbes is a really reputable group. Now, let's go deeper into these 7. When we say 7 transferable skills, there's kind of a definition here on the screen. We talk about these are skills that can be applied to all professions and are the foundation of having success in any career. So when you think about the power of that statement, skills that can be applied to any profession and that you could be successful in any career with the right transferable skills, what is that actually, you know, how critical do you think that is? Because I think, you know, sometimes we go and we learn a lot of things in jobs, but we're not always able to bring things with us that actually can go to the next job.
What comes to my mind with that statement is it that's the skills that are being defined there have a lot to do with how you do your work. So what I mentioned earlier about a technical skill that can work in one environment versus another, that's actually getting something done. But having the right skill as to how you do your work could be applied in any industry. I used welding earlier. The way that you, the skill you use to do a good job welding could also be used to do a good office job with customer service.
That's really
so
good.
So how you do the job has a lot to do with those transferable skills.
And maybe even the attitudes you have while you do it,
Absolutely.
And so I want to challenge us a little bit here tonight where we can maybe talk about the transferable skills that Forbes identified. And if we have some time left, maybe we can challenge ourselves to think about, can we take turns thinking of maybe a few more that we've learned in our experience that can transfer and be useful in almost any job. So so let's go through some of these. So I want to get, you know, we're gonna have to work it out on this and kind of talk through it. But one transferable skill that they identified was creativity. Now, I know creativity a lot of times has to do with the ability to think creatively, to think about more than one way to approach something. People that just almost have like this third eye or something. And they look for a different way of approaching things. And it causes people to, you know, see opportunities that may not have been there before. You know, what do you say about creativity?
I like what you said about that third eye. I mean, very creative people see gray in my mind. And like you can see there's black and white, but they can see gray in that there's something that's either a blend of what exists or it doesn't even exist at all. And they can create it. But back to what we said about how you do your work, you can be very, very creative in the way that you do a technical type of job, in the way that you do a sales-oriented job. But the other thing that comes to my mind as we're talking about creativity is when you go to interview and when the market looks at you, they can't necessarily look at your document and piece of paper to see how creative is this person. The indicators to see that when a person first meets you is how you describe what you do. I could say I do staffing and I call people to see if they're interested in a job. But if I describe that in a way to say I listen to how a person is speaking, I listen to how they describe what they're doing. I think about different details they may share, the results that they gave, the energy they, there's different things you could be looking at, but the way that person describes what they do could indicate to me their level of creativity.
And that's really something how you're going into that, because sometimes when people think about creativity, they think about art or,
yes,
you know, something that you can see.
Right.
But a creative thinker is actually creative about how they put things together, how they describe things, and how they approach things. That's kind of what you're getting at.
Absolutely. And I like what you said in one of the shows about problem solving. Mm-hmm. It takes a very creative person to come into a situation that could be a very tough situation and think about what could be the best solution. A creative person is actually better at problem solving sometimes than,
right,
a person who's not able to see that gray.
Right, and I think a big word in creativity is create.
Yes, right? That's right.
That means yeah, you're bringing something forth about, that wasn't there.
That's right.
So
it
that's
wasn't
the,
obvious.
It wasn't obvious.
Yes.
So really, I think when people are listening to this show, you know, when you think about creativity, the skill of being able to bring something to fruition or to make something come about,
yeah,
that others couldn't see.
That's right.
Is really a skill.
Yeah, it's actually very, very important. And I mean, you've trained us a lot. You've helped me a lot to think about, I can sometimes be very, very plain with the way I'm saying something, but if I can think of a visual or think of a way to express something I'm saying in a different way, it may help to make that point,
right,
connect with an audience. And it's something you have to learn.
Right, absolutely. So let's keep going. This is a good one, though, because,
yeah,
creativity is definitely a transferable skill.
And I would just add, yeah, it's a game changer. I mean, creativity is a game changer when you think of what we're talking about, being able to create what doesn't exist in any job, any field. The ability to go in and help people understand how you can create something that's not there gives a company a competitive advantage.
Right, because now you're changing the game.
Yes.
You know, this is someone actually has a bit. So I guess from a human resource perspective, you know, you would highly value a creative person because,
absolutely,
it's actually giving the business a chance to, you know, fight the competition with like this secret arsenal of things,
yes,
that don't exist yet.
That's right. Mm. It creates an advantage for us to compete in a way that's different from our competitors.
Right. Very, very good. So let's go a little bit deeper. Now, creativity is such a powerful one, but another one that is just as powerful in many different ways is communication skills.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I know a lot of people talk about communication, but let's talk about it some more, right?
Yeah.
Because communication, I mean, I can't tell you how paralyzing it is,
yeah,
to see people with so much professional know-how, so much talent, so much potential, and yet the inability to communicate,
yeah,
almost, you know, it almost handcuffs,
yeah,
the ability to appreciate what they bring to the table.
Yeah.
What have you seen just in your career and in your journey of how lethal,
yeah,
and yet how beneficial communication can be?
It's such an important skill, like you said. Yeah. I really enjoyed the series you did on Speak to Me, and there were some very important things that came out of that. Just so examples of things that, you know, that don't happen well in effective communication is, I'll just take a text example.
Right.
Someone says, I'm going to this store. Without knowing where you're going, what time you're going, who's going, are you by yourself?
Right.
There's so many,
right,
details.
Right.
But often those kind of examples happen.
Yeah. Or even worse, I'm going to the store that we went to that other day,
yeah,
or that other time.
Exactly.
And you have to remember, yeah, what day, what time, what are you talking about?
Which,
yeah,
store, right?
Yeah,
we
exactly
might have went to more than one. But it's those kind of things that happen all the time. And I share sometimes with my friends, we joke about, this is a good case study for effective communication, because sometimes, especially when you're communicating with people you have a good relationship with at work, friends, family, you assume,
right,
that there's a lot that's understood that's not. And,
right,
the worst case in a career is that assumption.
Right.
When you're communicating with a colleague or with a boss or with a team member and you're assuming there's a connection to a point you're making, again, it's like immediate disconnect
has, right,
happened.
And I think to your point, when we think, because again, our subject is transferable skills,
yeah,
it's amazing that if I know how to effectively communicate a message,
yeah,
how I can go to job A, mm-hmm, and do that,
yep,
go to a totally different job about totally different things,
yeah,
but there still is something that you're trying to convey to other people.
Yes.
And if you're good at doing that,
mm-hmm,
it, you know, whether I'm a 911 dispatcher, which,
yes,
is like, it's crucial,
yes,
or a salesperson,
yeah,
or someone that is working you know, at the city, yeah. but they're dealing with social work, where how you talk to people that's dealing with real pains in the community
yeah.
is just as critical. It's amazing to me how transferable communication is.
It is, and I like those examples you use, because the skill in communicating in those different examples is learning how does communication happen in this environment.
That's good.
So in some places, you know, where you may have learned how to get that message across a certain way, maybe in another environment, I have to do more written, have to do more nonverbal, or I have to. So learning how to communicate and navigate in an environment, and I think it ties so well with collaboration, because it's like you have to learn who to communicate with, how to communicate, and then ultimately how decisions are made. Because the more effective you are in communication, hopefully the better decisions.
Well, you're really kind of changing the game here with what you just said, because sometimes we look at communication as someone who's doing good at communicating, right? But you're bringing in another element, is that really good communication skill is the skill of knowing how in this environment, in this situation, to be a good communicator, right? Because then that means you might be in sales and everyone loves you because you're direct and you're straightforward and you look people in the eye and you close the deal and then you go to this other environment and you still trying to do that doesn't necessarily mean you're a good communicator, because you didn't see in this environment that's not transferable.
Right.
So you have to know that it's not what you were doing, like you said, it's how you do it for the environment you're in.
It's how you do it. And then, I mean, the example and the communication too with what you just said is knowing in one environment to communicate effectively is what I say, versus in another environment to communicate effectively is how I listen.
That's great. That's really good.
Right? It can make a big difference. Like in and you can think of different environments where it's all about what you say, sales.
Right.
It's all about what you say. You have to listen as well, but there's other environments, like in consulting.
Right.
You have to start with listening.
That's true. That's true. Effective. Which is communication.
It is.
Now, it's very good. So let's go to another one here. Y'all can see we got a lot to say about these. So sounds like Forbes has some good ones here. Now, another one that they talked about is developing technical skills. Now, you know, the visual here kind of alludes to software development, but technical skill is many different things. Yeah. You know, technology is everywhere. Our cell phones is a walking computer. There's, you know, desktop softwares that we use. There's, you know, technology we have to use now to communicate in conferences and meetings.
Yeah.
You know, almost every meeting you go to, now you gotta know how to, you know, set up something to get the webcam working right and all these different things.
Yeah.
So, you know, I think this is another critical thing, is if you learn how to do practical technical things that, you know, almost every business still needs, it also becomes very useful to an organization.
It's very important, because I'll just say it from a recruiting perspective. Let's just say a manager is looking for an accountant. The baseline skill sets that gets that person even seen is the fact that they have experience doing accounting, or they understand what accounting is. So I'm looking for that technical skill.
Right.
But every industry and every function has those baseline technical skills that are needed, you know, HR, communications, like you mentioned, technology. Mm-hmm. Those are like the keys to entry into a certain field. I will say those are often sometimes the easier skills for a person to learn and develop.
Right.
They are the ones that are, again, they're easier to learn. They're probably, the behavioral skills are the ones that are a little bit tougher.
Right.
So the technical skills get you in the door.
Right.
The behavior and the professional skills is what changes the game as to what you do after you're in the door.
That's a good point. That's a really good point. So technical, again, and we're really defining that as, because a lot of it can be steered around, you know, technical things and even technology that is used in business, but like, you're saying technical can also be looked at as being competent.
Yeah, in a particular field or function or industry.
Right,
just knowing, like sales,
right.
It's technical skill to know the process of selling.
Right, absolutely. Right. No, that's very good. Yeah. So let's keep moving there, because I know we got to get through all of these, but technical is another one.
Yeah.
Now, here was another one, is critical thinking. Now, this is way up there too. So being able to think critically about something. So, you know, sometimes people, you can give them certain types of work, that is about follow through and completing a task, but when you need someone to really think it through and think about what could go wrong, think about the things that, you know, that might come up and adjust for that, to include it in the plan, to critically break it down and build it back up again so that you can give something that's really seasoned to whoever needs it. I think that, you know, would you say that being a critical thinker is something that most businesses value extremely highly?
I do think so. And the fact that it's on this Forbes list, I think is very interesting because when I think about critical thinking, like, and I like the puzzle piece, a visual, that person is able to see the implications of an action. So they're, like you said, they're thinking through a certain problem. You actually talk a lot at in our office environment about systemic thinking. I mean, it's thinking broader than one particular task or item that has to be done, but that person who can understand the broader picture, the implications of something we're doing, and help us think about solving this problem and the future.
Right.
Again, critical impact for a company.
Right, absolutely. So you're also saying, you know, a lot of times when we hear the word critical, we think of something danger. You know, you say someone's in critical condition.
Right, there's a problem.
But it's a problem, but we're really saying, here's a person who can see the problem.
Yes.
They can think critical, they can see what is serious, right?
Mm-hmm.
And be able to convey how that is gonna impact the business.
Huge.
And so, so I think this is another really good one. So.
Yeah.
So we might come back to these, but I want to make sure we have some time for our little game at the end. So let's go to some more from Forbes. So Forbes also talked about multitasking. So multitasking is a skill. So, I mean, this is where you're starting to get into, you know, how many things can I do at the same time? How would you define multitasking? How do you describe it?
I have to say, there's actually different schools of thought on multitasking.
All right.
So I've literally been in settings where I've heard that a human, our human brain does not operate such that we can do more than one thing at one time.
Mm-hmm. I've heard that.
I've heard that, and part of me sometimes believes that to be true. At the other hand, I've used multitasking and talked about multitasking for years. And so I think I'm at a point where I'm thinking about where multitasking really is effective and helps on a job. I'm thinking about it in a different way from a perspective of, you know, are you multitasking when you're sitting in a meeting and you're listening to someone and planning your to-do list? What's happening
right there?
So it's interesting because there's some who say you can't and others who say it.
Well,
can.
I think if we play with the word multitasking a little bit and maybe look at it as how many tasks you can do in a defined amount
period of time.
I think that works because it's almost like the word life balance.
Yep.
Like, that's really not true.
Mm-hmm.
You can't do everything equally in your life.
Yeah.
So I like to talk about life rhythm because it's more true to, you know, finding what your rhythm is. But multitasking, if you say this person can be working on many things in 1 hour, that makes sense. So maybe the skill of being able to do multiple things in a defined period of time is how we need to now define multitasking.
I like that. That seems very practical.
Now, I don't know if that's what Forrest meant, but I think that that's the way you need to define it.
I think that's very, very practical. And I think it just gets to, is this person effective at executing over, like you said, within a certain period of time? How much can this person get done? Are they organized in the work they're doing? I really think that that's reasonable. And and when I think about different industries, it seems that would apply.
Yeah.
Just a person who can get a lot done within a short period
of time. Yeah, it definitely would be transferable. So let's go to the next one here. So another one that's pretty common is teamwork.
Mm-hmm.
Now, we know that teamwork is definitely a big one because, you know, like, who doesn't say teamwork in business,
right?
Sports teams, businesses, you name it, everyone talks about teamwork.
Yeah.
But I think the big thing about teamwork, and I want to hear what you say about this, is just, you know, not the cliche teamwork, but how many different personalities can you work with and be effective?
That's it.
You know, how would you add to what I'm saying? Do you agree with that?
I absolutely agree with that. Mm. And the key that you said is be effective. You can work with a lot of different personalities, and sometimes get things done. You know, is it working in the same room? Is it working on the same project? But actually being able to blend from a perspective of making effective exchange and communication, reaching decisions, reaching a result, getting a product designed or getting a task completed, you know? And it does, to your point about just working effectively, it really takes considering the other person to work well with different types of individuals. I've been in different environments where there's, you know, understanding how someone might be processing information that we're working on. If I'm taking a minute to think about how they might process it, what information they need to help contribute, if I'm thinking about them and giving myself and making adjustments in my own style to try to meet with them, it seems like that really, and people who are able to do that well, that's who you want on the team.
Absolutely, and another element just to add to what you're saying is that when you're in the struggle of teamwork, things come up, and how well do you adapt? So I might try to do everything right, but what about when things go wrong or the deadline is not met or stress comes in? Are you still able, so you can look at teamwork as the normal word teamwork, but you also can look at team work. In other words, the work of remaining a team, right? So once you have a team and you're trying to work together, can you stay in that work? Because it's a job to actually stay as a team.
It's funny you say that. What comes back to my mind is the stages of a team, like forming, norming, storming, a high performing team. A team, person who has a good skill at teamwork can be very effective with a new team that's just coming together. Like you said, teams go through different processes where you might get to conflict, you might have to adjust to figure out how are we really gonna operate till you can really perform well. But that person who can work with the team and help the team through that process, very, very important.
Absolutely, and I think sometimes people just don't realize, they think they're a good team player, but they don't see that even their team, their idea of team is still defined through the selfishness of their personality or their perspective. Instead of, you know, true teamwork is really, you know, being able to almost become a vessel and clay that can mold to what is needed for the team to win. Now, you just talked about storming, norming, and so forth. I kind of know where you were going with that, but for people who have never heard that before, give us a little bit on that.
So there's different stages of a team. Forming is typically when a team first comes together. Storming is after that team has come together, there's a period of time in figuring out what are the roles, how are we going to operate, how are we going to communicate, how are decisions going to be made, what are the roles. And then norming is after you've stormed and figured out how we're going to work, norming is when that team gets into a normal operation. We've got a frequency, we've got structure, we've got momentum, we know our tasks, we know our goals. And then you can get to high performing. And some teams can stay at a stage if they get stuck, or some can get to performing. But the key is it does take work for a team to continue to be high performing. You can get to high performing and then lose track. You can take for granted what you've gotten, and before you know it, you're back to storming.
And and a good person with good teamwork skill can go through all of those phases, because there's different dynamics.
And they can identify where the team is and be a very effective person at helping to see, if we don't keep this going, we might fall back. We want to keep make sure we're on the right path.
Absolutely, very good. So let's go to our last one here. And that is leadership. I mean, gosh, we could have a whole show on this. I need to have a show on this pretty soon, but leadership is just humongous. There's so much we could say about leadership, but and just saying a few words about leadership, when you hear that word, I mean, you've dealt with other executives, and for those of you that didn't see some of our past shows and know who Jahlil is here, you know, Jahlil has worked in many large organizations from Silicon Valley to other industries, been internationally recognized in working with other entrepreneurs, I should say other leaders in the corporate space. Now, and when you look at all of that activity you did, what comes to your mind about leadership through the lens of your career and what you've seen, the importance of it?
Like you said, it's such a broad term, but I just have learned the skill of leadership. It really builds on what we just talked about from teamwork, is a person who can think outside of themselves and really have all these things we talked about, creativity, critical thinking, use their skills to mold and create and replicate those skills within a team.
Right.
I mean, the leaders that stand out, that are good leaders, think beyond what, you know, I did or what I produced, but they think beyond what can I do to help this team produce. And so that selflessness really stands out in the good leaders.
Right.
And it also, the selfishness stands out in the leaders that, you know, that leave a stain of the ones you don't want to be like. You know, they say, think about the leader. Sometimes a negative experience with a leader can train you what you don't want to do when you become a leader. But there's so many things to cover.
So let me say this, because I know we don't have a whole lot of time, but I still want to see, can we get a few more that we come up with? But let me just say this, and how does this hit you when I say this and we wrap up on leadership, is that you can lead from in front, right? So sometimes you gotta be willing to jump in and show that you can do it too, and people be willing to follow that.
Yeah.
You can lead from behind, where you learn how to put people in front of you, and they still respect who you are, but you allow them to do more, but you're still leading, right? Then you can lead in your absence, right? So you invest so much in the team that you cannot be there, but you're there.
Yeah.
What do you say? What do you think about those three levels
there? That's so solid.
What do you say to that?
Some very important points there. And I think what becomes, as a leader has experience, they learn when to use those approaches that you talked about. They're all very, very important at the right time. And I think, you know, when what you said about the way you interact with the team, there's one important thing that comes to my mind with regards to just learning the experience that a team member has with a leader is the eyes and the window for that employee into what this whole who this whole company
is. I know, isn't that something? Yeah.
Like an employee can have an opinion about a company.
Yeah.
Based on their experience with a leader.
Right.
So just that responsibility and weight.
Right.
What you just said, knowing when to act a different way with the team at the right time.
Right.
If it's done the right way, that employee, you know, they say loyalty has gone out of the business world, and to some degree it has gone out from the way people define it. But people like to work for good leaders who will invest in them. And so when you get to competitive advantage and competing in the market, having good leaders could make or break a company's success.
Absolutely. And I know, just to close this out, is that leaders, you know, I often like to call them seed planters, right? But the garden is the business. And the garden is not yours.
Right.
You're just a leader in that garden.
That's
so when you start planting seeds that are not supposed to grow there, it's a very, you know, it could be a dangerous thing.
That's
so
right.
I like what you said.
And you can do it unconsciously if you're not careful. So just being conscious of what am I planting. And if you do plant the wrong thing, it's okay to always go back.
Yeah, root that seed out there.
Unroot that?
Yeah.
You know, I mean, really, just the
humility
to apologize.
And that's a sign of good leadership, too.
Absolutely.
Yeah, apologize.
Fix it quick and let's move on.
Absolutely. So this has been great. I know we're at the end of our show here. We're just going to do a quick speed round. So we don't have a lot of time to talk. We just got some seconds here left. But what are a few things, you know, I'm going to let you go first.
All right.
So something that's not a no seven that you think is a transferable skill that can help someone in their career?
Collaboration is my first.
All right. So just a real brief sentence about collaboration.
So working effectively with others.
Okay.
Yeah.
How do you see that different than teamwork?
I see collaboration as a person who knows how to go outside of a team they're in and connect effectively.
That's good.
To partner and get things done.
Very good. All right. Well, I'm going to throw one in. I'm going to say patience. I think somebody that is a very patient individual, because patience is required for good business ideas to come to fruition, teams to work well together. I think you got to have a little patience, and I don't know any business or career that you wouldn't need it.
Yeah,
you know.
That's
so,
right.
So, what's another one from you?
I'm gonna go with approachability. I think
all
I think all of these skills we've talked about. a person who's approachable, like, has a lot of impact on whether you can communicate well, whether you're a good teammate, collaborate well. Just to have a nice appearance and a approachability, meaning that you can, a leader can be approachable by anyone at any level in an organization and within a team.
Very good, very good. Well, the last one that I'll throw out there then, I'm gonna go with discipline.
Nice.
I'm gonna go with discipline.
That's
because
important.
I think, you know, discipline on a few different levels, discipline to stay true to whatever it is you have to do and to really be able to do that.
Yeah.
But also the word disciple comes from that too. Mm. Being able to follow, you know, being able to follow a standard, follow a team, follow a leader, follow direction. I think that is very, very important as well.
So I think that ties into the examples you used on leadership, leading from, you know, in front, leading from behind, being willing to follow plays a big part
Absolutely.
Of that.
Well, I think we did pretty good.
That's great.
So there's
high
more.
Five.
Yeah, high five. I think there's more we could do. So I hope you all enjoyed this show. Again, we talked about transferable skills as promised. And so I want to remind you, as always, before we go, if you have not registered to join the movement, join at youareaceo.com. Register, download our applications, be a part of the movement. This is not just this one show. We talk about this and much more in life, career, and business all the time. So make sure you become a part of this movement. Also, I always talk about live, learn, and earn. We want to live the life, an uplifted life, a mind-fit life, where we can stay focused on taking our lives forward, and we always want to be learning, learning how to overcome those four enemies of you are a CEO: self-ignorance, fear, mediocrity, and insecurities. And so if you love what you're hearing, join the movement, join the club, become a part. And last but not least, you can earn by being a part of URSales affiliate program, and you'll be excited to hear that helping to spread the word and giving more people the opportunity to be the CEO of their life, you can be earning as you go. So I want to tell you about our next show, and I've got a favor to ask you. Can you come back just one more time? I'm loving this. This has been great.
I would be happy.
It's
this
like old time.
Awesome. It really has.
All right. Well, you heard it here. I got a commitment here. So listen, this is our next show on May 20th. We're going to talk about building a network. This is going to be our final show of this career series, talking about being the CEO of your career. And listen, this is critical to your career, is learning how to build a network and leverage it for your career success. I hope you enjoyed this show. I'm Michael Lee Parker, and I still have with me Jahlil Stewart. And this has been another wonderful show on CEO TV Live. Wherever you find yourself, keep going out there, letting people know you're the CEO of your life. You run the business of you, and let the whole world know that you are a CEO. We'll see you next week. Have a good evening.